Welcome to the new Dawn Meeting of the Mind, brought to you by Trax Radio, and we meted and we minded and we are collaborated. Welcome everybody to the new show, and welcome. Thank you guys for, agreeing to relaunching the new Dawn show. So how's everyone feeling?
Great, mate. Really looking forward to it.
Fantastic. And we've got in the house, going from the top, we've got Antics. Nick Sheldon's just disappeared somewhere. And we've got Cherokee at the bottom. How are you doing, Nick? You okay? Is that a yes or no? you had a party last night, didn't you? You were out clubbing, DJing, doing what you do.
I was just messing around on a load of tunes, getting ready for the boat on May the 18th, the Amphemia boat party. So I'm just knocking mixes out and just, going for it.
Yeah,
loving the tunes at the moment. It's all good.
So, just a little bit about the show. There's myself, Daz Willett, and being hosted with Trax own radio, Shelly Ann in the house. So
that is me.
So we've been working on this since Christmas, haven't we, guys? Really, getting this together. The first one being the podcast. Just to explain a little bit about what's coming. What's to come. We've got some tunes. You've all picked a track from, old school. You've picked a recent track as well that we're going to play. And hopefully we're going to have people in chat asking questions. If not, we'll just ask questions ourselves, Shell.
I've got plenty.
I mean, Shell was a massive New Dawn fan, weren't you?
Huge.
How did you come to know about New Dawn?
Oh, my Shell. New Dawn story. While I was only little, I don't need to make everyone feel really old, but I was only about 10 when New Dawn kicked in. And the people we hung out with, they were all doing the clubs and, they were all going to see the DJs, and there was little old me and a couple of us, and we didn't. So this was our way, really, and our introduction into this kind of music, and I was sold from the off, really. We used to just go into a pool room of a pub with a bit of a ghetto blaster someone would bring along. I think one guy that was old enough to drink would buy one pint, and we used to just sit there all night on Sunday and listen to you guys. So that's what got me into it. So that's my story.
So, going to the New Dawn story, Antics, what about yourself? Where did it start for you with New Dawn?
Back in the day, everyone wanted to be a DJ, didn't they? I managed to get some decks, I had some records, and there was a local record shop near it was in Altrincham. And I ended up working there on a Saturday morning. Well, on a Saturday, we'd load up the decks every week, and we'd take all the stuff down at the basement, and we'd start playing tunes and selling them. Got paid in vinyl. And it was whilst I was there, I was asked whether or not I would be willing to go and DJ for a new promotion outfit called New Dawn. And of course it was yeah. And that's how I got into it. That's how I got started. It bunch of luck. I was in the right place at the right time.
And you got the best radio voice as well. It was just like a winner, wasn't it? Double whammy.
Well, there was no radio show at that point.
Yeah, but they couldn't believe the luck. They knew they knew what was happening.
What about yourself, Antics?
Do you mean Scott?
Scott.
Hi, Daz. Cheers for having us on. My journey was, it's a long story, but basically I can't really remember.
Sorry, Cherokee. I knew I'd get that wrong. I have problems with your name, buddy.
At the same time, Antics was being invited to play for this New Dawn Promotions. I'd done some demo tapes. I'd been DJing for a while and was really looking to start DJing in clubs, and I did a demo tape funnily enough, for Shelley's, because I was going there every weekend. I was a proper raver, and there was a DJ on the side, but I wasn't a rave DJ at that point. In the club scene, in that sense, I was in Bolton doing normal nightclubs, being quite successful as that, but not in the club scene as we know it, as that kind of scene. So I put a tape into Shelley's, and somehow this tape got sent in to New Dawn Promotions as well, by as luck would have it. And I got a call and was asked to go down and do a little sort of trial night around someone's flat. I think it was maybe Trax's. Was it Trax's flat, James?
He was. It was him and another guy. Lived in this tiny little house in Macclesfield. Couldn't see a cat in there.
And I remember turning up and there's all these DJs in this little room and we're all mixed together. And off the strength of that, they were like, we'll have you on. And that's how I got started with New Dawn. But as James said, that was way before the radio show as we knew it on Signal.
Yeah, so I mean, New Dawn really started before, you know, well before the radio. And I think a lot of people don't realise that who were listening to the show, because obviously it started in the clubs. I mean, Rock World, The Limit is really my connection as well to New Dawn. You know, because the guys from The Limit, obviously Mike, and I think George, we can safely say that, was he involved at the time? Or
I think at the start, was it Mike and Colin?
Oh, Mike and Colin. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and George, right at the beginning.
Oh, well, they're all there, right?
Yeah.
I thought so, and you know, that was my... I used to do Entropy and then come over after Entropy and do, you know, the graveyard set, but it was amazing. It was like as if it was peak time. That club was peak... I mean, it was back then, wasn't it? It was all peak time from opening to close, you know, I mean... You know, it's not like today where you have the peak time and everyone sort of disappears at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. And what about you, Nick? Mr. Sheldon, yourself? Doctor.
Doctor.
Tell us a little bit about your nickname on the New Dawn on Signal Radio, Nick.
Well, I thought you'd bring that up. So... Well, you want the illicit version, the full X-rated. Obviously I'm Nick Sheldon, but there was a porn movie out.
We're going there, are we?
We are.
We're going there already.
I can't lie. And Ron Jeremy, he played a character called Dr. Sheldon. Hence why I took on the name, because I think we put our own dubs over the video and sent it to someone and that as well. It's just funny.
I just think it's a funny connection, the doctor, you know. I always think of the prescription, going to the doctor and getting a prescription.
Well, the thing is, my mum's cousin told us going on the New Dawn again, and then she said... I remember coming back on a Sunday night, driving with your dad, and we were listening to you. And he turned and goes, "You're calling him the doctor." Because I think that must have been when it just happened, so they didn't even know.
I mean, it was good, wasn't it? I mean, you know, DJs were coming, you know, you like Cerati, Psy, Groove Rider, Stu Allen. You know, it started to gain a lot of interest, you know.
Lauren Garnier, remember as well?
Yeah.
Right at the beginning.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
it was amazing.
I mean, this show is just like a chat, and if anyone's got any questions, please ask. And we are going to be starting the show, aren't we? Where we're going to be having you guys DJing as well, with, you know, hopefully with some guests, and it will be all visual with camera, you know. So that's something to look forward to. But this show is just a little bit chatting about yourselves, chatting about memories, that type of thing. And we have got a couple of tracks each, haven't we, to play as well. So, I want to go with you first, Cherokee, your tracks. So you're gonna pick an old school track and also a new school track, because when we were putting the show together, Shell, we were talking about, like, the concept of the show, and You know, back then it was all new music, wasn't it? Old school was kind of what, 12 months old, and you were going back to like the early Hacienda days, where, you know, it was all predominantly new, wasn't it? Fresh music that was being played. So we discussed, and Nick brought it up that, you know, we think we should still keep playing new stuff as well. Yeah, you know, as well. Yeah. So that's what we're doing tonight. It's an old school and new school track. Tell us a bit about this track that you picked. Why have you picked this track, being that it's your first one?
Well, it was so hard. Because it's one track from hundreds of thousands that were absolute bangers and classics, and there've been loads of great tunes posted by everyone on the New Dawn group as well. Really appreciate everyone putting those on there and sharing that. That's been fantastic. Ones we might not have heard for a while, or that you're really familiar with, but this one is one that people will be familiar with. But for me, it was really, really personal, because me and the group of people that I was like my closest mates, that, you know, helped me, support me, go to all the early events that I was doing when I wasn't really a big DJ, or not that I'm particularly a big DJ right now, but it's kind of like supporting me at that time when I was starting out. And this was a tune we always used to listen to more when we were chilling out, maybe.
It's funny that you should say a chilling out track, because the actual track that you picked was massive for myself, for Entropy and Shelley's. Yeah. It's funny, back then, they were chilled out tracks, but they had a massive impact. And
still play them at the peak time. Absolutely.
You could. Yeah. Where, you know, if you dropped it now at peak time, people sort of disappear off the dance floor.
Well, hopefully not.
We're
good enough to set them up properly.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Have you got the rave mix of this that I see?
It's the white label copy.
Yeah, it is the rave mix, right. I think.
Yeah, so
the rave mix shouldn't have the vocal on it, the rap on it, and that's why I said it.
No. It was the original one, and it's the one that we were all playing.
I haven't heard this yet, so this is a bit of a surprise. I've heard none of this music yet, so.
Do you want me to give the title?
Yeah, you can do. Yeah, you can give the title. Yeah.
It's Bug Khan and the Plastic Jam.
Ooh.
And it's made in 2 minutes.
Yeah.
How long it took him to make it, or something along those lines.
When I say it, you know, it cleared the dance floor, I don't mean it literally would, because it is a good track. I mean, it's kind of one of them tracks that, you know, it's kind of, it is very chilled, isn't it? It's a nice one. Yeah, timeless.
We're getting some great response, by the way, about that tune, Scott. Yeah, nice. Yeah, we're getting a lot of people enjoying your choice there, mate.
Good, good, good. Okay, let's play it. So here we have it. Thank you. Yeah, so it is an absolute corker of a track, isn't it, without a doubt, you know?
Yeah, it's so, so it's beautiful, so simple. It just takes you somewhere, doesn't it?
Yeah. You know, I think that was like peak time track, you know, as well. Yeah. Mind you, you couldn't really move much back then, could you? You were just like, you know, you were just like swaying.
I can remember that track, actually. I can remember, I'm sure Sasha used to drop that track now and then as well. But yeah, I can remember that. I used to really enjoy that track, so that was a nice surprise, that one, wasn't it? What a first track to start with, though. How are we going to keep up with this?
many a good tune that everyone likes, I'm sure.
what about you, Nick? Was that a track for you? Was that in your set back then?
Yeah, massive.
Yeah, yeah.
It was great because it's obviously a little break beaty, so it was in all the jungle sets as well. The DJ used to drop it, speed it up and that, because there's another mix on the other side, the rave mix with the rapping on as well.
I think the rapping is the other side,
Actually, that was a white label, and then they re-released it, and they spoilt it by putting the release on with the rap over the top. There was something about that track being, it was a pressing, the sample was used, and it shouldn't have been used. There was some story to it, if you dig about it. Yeah, I remember there was something about it, and that's why they put the rap, because the rap version is different. It even sounds different, if you listen. It's not the exact track.
No, it isn't.
They had to change it.
It's got a different beat on it as well.
Yeah, they had to change it due to some licensing laws.
Ooh.
So,
I mean, I always put that track on the same vein as like Orbital Belfast.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, and what about your antics? James used to drop it.
Still got a mute.
Are you with us there?
Yeah, I am. Sorry, David. Yeah.
You're right, bud. We're still getting used to it. We're trying to mute on the track so we can't hear any anything going on in the background, like any whatever. It's all new to us, this technology, isn't it? You know.
You didn't have this back then, did you?
But yeah, I did have a copy of it. It was it was always in the record box. It's one of those tracks that
it's sweet,
massive. Yeah, but I didn't have that original version. I had the general release of it, I'm afraid. Not on the pool.
And your head in shame, James.
I knew someone was going to say that.
Oh, I'll tell you what, there's going to be some banter on this show. I can see it coming. It's like, wow, claws out. Okay, right. Okay, who wants to go up next?
I think we should go back probably again to you, Scott, and I think you should tell us a little bit about the new track you've chose, because again, I have not heard this either. So.
Yeah, we might as well have them both play the tracks together. Yeah,
I think yeah, great stuff.
Yeah, sounds good.
If I'd have known it, I'd mixed them together. But yeah, so I kind of, it's like 33 years ago since I last did a New Dawn sort of meeting, that kind of time, isn't it? 30 odd years, something like that, since we last did this. So this is really special doing this again. And when I thought about a new track, there's so many I could have gone for there again, but this one I came across, I think it's from 2017, so it's not that new. That's seven years ago, isn't it? But it's by Dusky, and I heard this. I think I was just listening for music online. You know, I've had a little listen around various online music shops and that, and I'd met someone who I was working with. I'd fallen out of kind of music to some degree. Life had taken over, had a kid, all that was going on, so... but I started getting back into music, and I heard this tune. I thought it just sounded like something from back in the day that I would love to have played.
Mm-hmm.
But it was produced in 2017 by Dusky.
Is it Ingrid?
It's not Dusky. It's called...
No, is it Ingrid as a hybrid?
No, it's it's called Angles.
Right, well, have you heard of Ingrid as a hybrid?
I don't think I have.
Oh, mate. Check that one out.
All right. Yeah.
Hey, maybe if we've got time at the end of the show, we can have a look for it.
Well, we could do. Have a little look. Yeah. But what I will do is with all the tracks as well, is when I publish this up, because this will all be published on Mixcloud anyway, is I can tagline all your tracks anyway, so we can, so everyone, if they forget what they are, don't worry, they will be tagged in the published mix for you. So I think we'll have a listen, eh?
Yeah, let's go for it. So, this is Dusky Angles.
I'm loving angles again. Ruined it for you, that one.
Yeah, another ambient style. I see what you mean with that.
It's quite dark, that is.
Yeah, it is.
People will always know that. Maybe they don't know, but listen to what I used to play on New Dawn on the radio rather than in the club. I always played a bit more techno and slightly heavier, sort of darker stuff. And I really love the euphoric side of that. It's got a really nice dark driving edge to it. It's nice.
You all right, Nick?
I'm dying.
He's dying.
Quick.
We've killed him all.
Wrap it up, wrap it up.
That's it, I'm going.
But yeah, love that tune. When I heard it the first time, that whole EP, the Acid Forever EP, there's a couple of other tunes on there that, two or three of them are really great out of five. They're all really listenable. That one just edged it for me, especially for like a Sunday night.
What year was it, that one?
2017, I think.
All right, okay. 2017. Okay.
I've heard that one before, Scott. So,
well, that's a great thing, isn't it? I mean, like we do on the radio show, that's the beauty of it. We get to play slightly different things and pick up on new tunes from each other as well as share them with everyone else.
While we're talking about new and old tunes, people in chat, just let us know. Do you think, you know, we should do new, old? I mean, when you guys mix, it's up to you then. And if you want to play, drop some, old school and some new school. Do you think it should be 50-50? Or do you just leave it up to you guys, you DJ, and play how you play? Let us know in the comments, people. Be interesting to hear, your views as well. I think that's important to get their kind of take on it.
Like when you guys go out DJing now, do you stick to like your old school, like what you used to play back then, or do you play all new music, or do you just sort of mix it up a bit, or does it just depend on the gig?
I'm going in order. Go on, Nick.
Go on, Nick.
No, put my hand up.
Yeah.
Yes, please. Thank you, Nick. That makes it easier. Thank you, Nick.
Okay. I'm playing. Obviously, I do the old school reunions and stuff. But for the boat parties and stuff, I'm playing all new stuff, and I will drop the occasional one in when you've been into it. You know what I mean, and it's great because the music at the moment is so good. It is so good, and it's great that you can still drop the old stuff into it, you know, and it flows.
Yeah.
And you can just pick it up and pick everyone's interest again, have a sing along, whatever. Yeah, I'm really excited about the music at the moment.
The new stuff is that, Nick. I mean, I know you've always been the forefront, really, haven't you? To go forward, really. You haven't got stuck in the old school.
No, but I mean, I still, like I say, I still play the old stuff when I'm needed to do it. But you got to look at it like when New Dawn was on, when did the radio. Like I say, it was all new stuff, wasn't it? So, and if it hadn't, then obviously the radio probably would have died, before that.
Yeah.
I think you need to keep moving on. And there's, like I say, there's so much talent out at the moment. A lot of good producers. And it's so well produced. So.
Yeah, I discovered a new genre last night called mid-tempo.
Nintempo?
Mid-tempo music.
I mean, it sounds like a Tetris remix or something.
No, you've heard of it, Shel.
I have heard of it, yeah.
It's very Prodigy style. Guitars, very, very, very good, actually. I was quite impressed with it. I thought, this is different.
So what about you, Scott? What do you tend to play when you play out now?
So, yeah, because I get invited, nice, very, very gratefully. I mean, Jamie Robinson, I've put a big shout out to him. He rang me a couple of years ago and he said, you DJ Cherokee? Because I wasn't DJing then, doing the kind of gigs I'm doing now. I was still playing a little bit of vinyl and mixing, but just like pubs and bars. And he invited me to play some old school at their Golden Days Ultimate Catch-Up gigs. And I didn't know they'd been listening to my tapes from back in the day in the radio, and they were big fans, and I had no idea. And he rang me up and he said, are you Cherokee? Did you do that Charlie double mix and all this kind of stuff? And I was amazed to find that, you know, I had this kind of, like, at least three or four people that knew of me and kind of been listening to my tapes over the years. And he was, and he invited me back to play for them. So I play the kind of music that I used to play then. Yeah. Old school. But what I love to do is search and pick and dig a little bit around so that it's not all the floor fillers you hear all the time. And I'm just trying to bring a slightly different edge to it and bring a bit of scratching and live kind of performance in there. Still doing vinyl as much as possible to bring that really kind of authentic sound to it like it used to be. Don't get into the DJ vinyl, digital vinyl battle here. It's not about that. It's about just what I prefer doing and what I like to play and that sort of sound that I like.
To be honest with you, though, the vinyl side of things, it's good to see, isn't it, the authenticity. You know, people love to see, like, the performance with the vinyl. It's the original way, isn't it, you know?
I think there's really? Room for everything. There's room for everything. And
there is.
Nothing should be out. Yeah, everyone can... Bring
personal choice
and do what they like, exactly.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think so as well.
I will drop a few new ones in, and that's the thing, isn't it? You know, I'll try and as much as possible to bring new ones in because that's what's exciting to a DJ is to create that kind of moment when you drop something new and people really get it. You know,
it's just lost the appeal of going into a store and going through the music and going up to the counter and what have you got underneath? Yes. What's under the counter? You know, what's behind the counter tracks? You know,
what's under the counter? What's on the top shelf?
I don't know what shop Stas has been going to.
You know,
have you got any of that special brown bag stuff?
What I mean, though. You know, you go in there and you get familiar face, don't you, with the store owner, and it's like, I've got one for you, you know, and you sort of build up that rep. That's gone now, hasn't it?
Yeah,
you know,
it's used to work in a record shop, you see. That's great as well.
So,
what about you, James? Finally coming over to you. What do you like to play? The back in the day stuff or the new stuff?
Both. I like both. For me, it doesn't come down to how old it is. It's about quality.
That's
timeless. You know, you can. Hopefully, you will appreciate when I play the two tunes of mine that the modern one just sounds like it could have come straight out in 1999. Right. And for me, that was enough. I hear something, if it's good enough to be played, I don't care when it was made.
I mean, I like some of the remix tracks as well that they've made today. You know, they've put a like heavier beat in, they've energized it up a little bit, and I do like that. You know, I think it's just gives it that little bit more energy. I think it's good.
There's one thing I don't like about digital in general. Right? Don't hang me for this.
Oh dear.
When you had vinyl, there was an element of exclusivity to a tune. Mm-hmm. You buy it, you own it, nobody else has it.
It was a product.
Yeah. Whereas now, it's not, you know, anyone can download anything. And it's instant.
The limited edition's gone, haven't they, really? You know, now, you can't really get a limited edition MP3.
Well, you can't. You'll find it somewhere. There's always somewhere to find it, isn't there? There's no exclusivity, is there, anymore with, you know, like you say.
Sorry, go ahead, Nick. Nick?
Put your hand up, Nick. Yeah.
Obviously, I've still got all my vinyl and I can still, you know, still play the vinyl. I am 90% controller now. But what I miss, because I used to like play something that, you know, some people weren't playing, so I'd like play a lot of B-sides, different mixes, and you don't get that anymore. It's just like a faceless file. And it was awkward at first when you started because I never really knew many of the tracks' names anyway, because you knew it by the cover.
That's true. You know what I mean? Yeah.
I think we all did.
I had to start remembering names. And I'm,
oh, yeah. Dyslexic. And it's like you see a list of tracks and it's like, well, it's like a Bible, isn't it? Like reading a Bible of music in front of you. You know, but no, you did used to get used to the covers. You could actually go through your tracks and you could see it pop out the colour of the, you know, the sleeve when you were there straight away. And I think, you know, all that kind of is lost, really, isn't it?
I mean,
you know?
I think in the chat then, Dan Shaw's just made a really good point, actually, that he does agree with us to a certain extent, although there's a vast amount of new music, there's every chance you'll find something that many have missed, which is true as well, isn't it? There's so much out there. You know, it's...
Every cloud.
Well, that's it.
That's it. Pros and cons to it. Personal choice, and I mean, it's tools, isn't it, as well? It's all been tools that have helped us to progress as DJs. I mean, I love my controller, I love my effects, I can go on 3 decks, 4 decks, it's linked, everything's all synced, all my samples, you know, as a performer, I love to perform that way. Where with a vinyl, you put the needle to the groove and you just wait to the break and then that's it.
Mm.
You know, that's, you know, I've been there and I've done that, and it's with old school, it's just, I don't know, because there's only so many old school tracks you can play as well. So I like to like mix it up with, you know, effects and just give it a bit of a different feel. So I love that for the, that's my take on digital and the controller side of things.
I've only been taught on a controller, so I haven't got the beauty of, you know, I mean, obviously I had a play on, well, my brother used to have some decks, so I used to have a little play on them when I was a lot younger, but I wouldn't say I was DJing, I was just messing about.
She was DJing.
Not really. No,
you were DJing, Sam.
Not
yourself.
Really,
that's how we all started.
I don't believe that.
I suppose. But I haven't got the beauty of comparing, you know, which one I really like the best. I mean, to me, if I've said it before, if I had a choice of, you know, going to see like a really good DJ on a controller or going to see a scratch DJ on vinyls, I'd pick the scratch DJ, because to me there's something nice and there's something really good about watching and listening to a vinyl DJ. I know other people haven't got that opinion, but that's just me, and I just like the
old
the
school sense. Authentic.
Yeah, it is, mm. and it's nice, and it is.
It's an art,
and it's getting rarer.
It's an art.
You know, it's not very often you find vinyl DJs on gigs these days. So, and it's nice to go and see a vinyl DJ. I like it.
Yes, we've all got a different taste. It's an art, isn't it, at the end of
it
the day?
It is. It's a skill and it's an art, so...
I mean, it'd be interesting to the digital DJs on the controllers if you were giving them, you know, sort of some of the old-school vinyls and said, go have
no,
a mix on them.
Don't get ideas, Daz.
Okay, so let's move on. We've got another two tracks.
And this is James. Would you like to introduce your old school track, please?
Yeah, well, my first choice, and it was, like Scott said, it is so difficult to pick one. Because there's a whole host of different tunes. But the one that I went for was probably, I saw this guy live in the early days, up in Manchester Academy, in the very, very small one on the top floor, where there's only about 40 people in there. It's a tiny venue. And it was just before he really broke and made it big time. The tune was massive. Everybody knows it. Everybody will know it.
Yeah.
And it is an anthem. But the reason I've gone with it is, at the time, when I first heard it, it was just like, wow.
Mm.
And I can remember the first time I heard it. And it made such an impression on me. I just thought, yeah, that's got to be the one.
Yeah.
I've chosen Go by Moby.
Yeah, I did recognise this one, actually, from the name. So that's...
it's just haunting, isn't it? The, you know, the strings. Anyway, let's have a listen.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think we can all agree, absolute classic. And again, another steady track that would be played at peak time.
Yeah, I love that. Absolutely love that. I actually played that not so long ago in like a little cocktail bar, but it was like a really like electro-y sort of version. So the intro was a little bit different and a bit longer, but it's great. It's got a great build on, hasn't it, as well? And that like that sample, that go is everywhere, isn't it? It's been sampled that much, but just doesn't age, does it, that one at all?
No. I mean, he's done a few, hasn't he, as well, you know. There's other ones as well that, you know, just as good.
Definitely.
So, Antics, James, track two, your new choice.
he's actually, Moby's released an album, I think it was last year, where he's revisited a load of his tunes and redone them, and he did rework Go. It's not my second tune, I'll just like throw that in there, but I think it was called Reprise, the album, where everything is really stripped back, and it's good. It's worth a listen, that album, definitely. But my second tune is something that, and I just heard it the first time I heard it, it was just like last year, oh my god, this is mega. It's called Blackpool Boulevard, and it's by a guy called Barry Can't Swim. And you'll as soon as just play it, Daz. As soon as everyone hears it.
We listened to this, didn't we, when we were prepping the show on Friday?
We had a little sneaky listen, yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah.
And, it's very good.
Thank you. I didn't do it, but it's my choice.
It's nice.
Thank you.
Yeah, so, yeah, another nice choice there. Yeah, very instrumental and uplifting. Oh, definitely you that, Antics. Definitely screams James that.
Yeah, I love the strings in that. Absolutely lovely, aren't they?
James, mute.
You're on
mute,
here we
bud.
Go again.
It's okay. It's okay, bud.
It's just everything that it should be, isn't it?
Mm, absolutely. Yeah, it's really good. Really, really enjoy that. And it is really uplifting, isn't it?
Different.
Proper uplifting.
Yeah.
It's got an old school feel to it, you know, as well.
Yeah, it has, definitely. It's really good.
No, that's what we're saying, you know, it's not about when it was made, it's about what it is.
Yeah.
It's just about the quality. And there's a lot of good music out there, and I wouldn't want to discount playing stuff just because it's not old.
Mm. Yeah, and I think this is the key, isn't it? I think, you know, leave it up to you guys, you know, we have asked, and we are getting some feedback with the old school.
Yeah.
You know, there seems to be a lot wanting the old school, which is great, but we can, you know, I'm sure we can balance this out, can't we? You know, if you guys, you know, we can balance it out in the sets.
Oh, just reading Dan's comment here. Dan Shules just messaged in. Just says, absolutely, we can trust in the selection and taste of these guys. Back then, as much as I would now. So
nice.
Oh, that's lovely. Yeah. Thanks, Dan. That's nice.
Thank you for your vote of confidence.
Big up, Dan. Happy days.
Well, that's it. I mean, you knew what you were doing back then. It doesn't change now, does it? Do you know what I mean? It's the same, isn't it? So, yeah, definitely.
Okay, so up next is Mr. Sheldon, the doctor.
Is there a doctor in the house?
Doctor in the
house,
you know, it isn't that one, is it, Nick?
No, it isn't. I'm gutted now, kicking myself. Rewind.
Anyway. Rewind my selector.
So,
first track.
Mark, am I talking now, or are you?
You are, yeah. First track, old track.
I thought you muted me. Right, so the first track was Soul Odyssey Rapture. So when I was before New Dawn, obviously I was brought in to the galleries, like the sort of Stoke connection when they came down to Stoke. So I was Minstrels, Freetown, and I was doing a lot in Venue 44 at Mansfield.
All right, yeah.
The Arcana and the Rewind Nights were good. And this tune, I don't know, it's banging, basically.
Yeah, it's a good track.
Proper warehouse, filthy, deep tune with just an epic break, so...
Yeah,
you do like those kind of tracks, though, Nick. I mean, when you were down at the Raw show, and you've always played like sort of a B side or the second track in, or an acid mix, or a darker side. Like, you know,
I do like me dubby stuff.
Yeah,
I like mixing bass lines, and you know, just making you move and feeling it. I like to feel the music. That's one of the reasons. I mean, sorry, going back to the digital thing, whatever it is. When I play out, I want to be as excited as the punter.
Yeah.
If I'm playing all stuff all the time, there's only so much you can play. I'm not knocking the old stuff because I play it, you know what I mean? But I think it needs to be mixed up with the new stuff. So
I find that really interesting because I've never thought of it in that way as well, that you don't sort of get the same buzz because you're used to it.
Exactly.
And you've been playing it so much. So yeah, that's quite a good point, actually. I've never thought of it like that.
That's why with me with the controller, that's why I like my effects and being able to use samples. It gives me the ability to, you know, just to freshen it up a bit. Because you when you played old school, the DJ before has probably played it like three DJs before and it's getting played again, you know, throughout the night. That's a problem with old school nights. But this is a really good track, Nick, actually. And
old school, is it? It's not your
No.
It's not one that you think, oh right, yeah. It's, I feel like to go
This is a track that I can listen to over and over and over again. I'd never get tired of this.
I think the choices have been great, Shell June.
Yeah, you know, great.
So, do you just want to? Have you got a reason for this track, Nick? Have you got a reason? Is there any personal connection to it? Is it that
when it was like 92-93, I was always on that progressive tip. Yeah. And this just fits in with, well, it's just filthy, basically.
just like you.
Filthy.
You'll need a shower after.
Oh,
anyway.
We love a bit of filth.
Well, I love your bedside manner.
I love the banter.
It is a monster. Isn't it?
Yeah. Let's just let it play.
Big to dance your 2044.
Yeah, absolute classic track. Nick, I need to ask you something. The sample of that in the background, is that the original or is it taken off another track? It's in the back.
Intoxication beat.
That's the one.
Yes.
And also, it's very much similar to Corporation and One, the real life. It almost, yeah, it's very similar with the strings. I don't know if you noticed.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's yeah, the mint tune.
It never gets old, does
no,
it?
No, not no, not at all.
The people, 150 people are agreeing, so it's all good.
Yeah,
yeah. But so, yeah, tune so with all the new DJs, I've just dug out my vinyl version, oh, mate.
Yeah. You buggy.
I think about that. It's in near mint condition, though. I can't believe it because the rest are absolutely fucked.
Yeah, but every one of us had that.
So the intoxicated, yeah. So I wonder what the time period from that being released to that. How many? You know what's the...
That was 93, beginning of 93, and the intoxication was, I think, middle 92, something like that.
Or... All right, okay. Yeah, so it was getting, just as it was starting to get into that new progressive house, which was, isn't yeah, it really?
The intoxication thing, and also Left Field did a great dub of it as well.
That would have been played at Maxim's without a doubt, absolutely sure of it.
Mm.
That's your first track, Nick.
Let's hear your second.
Tell us a bit about it.
The second one, I mean, this I came about with the whole argument of playing new old stuff, so I thought, I'll tell you what, I'll pick one. It's from 2019, and I picked it because it basically got the same sort of break. And it's now this is a builder. It's quite epic strings building up, and then it takes you obviously to the same break as that. But it's more of a driving tune than that one. That one's more of a pumper, if you know what I mean. You'll know what I mean anyway, probably.
So yeah, so this is so
I'm
you know.
Be wrong.
But it's good to get this is what we thought about the show would have sort of because we were talking about should the show be old school, should it be new, and this is when we decided, you know, that yeah, a mix of new and old. So it's good to hear your choices of music out going forward, what would be in your sets type things. So yeah. I think it is great. So yeah, so any connection to this, Nick, why did you in a special place or
No, it's just that when I've played it, it's gone off.
Okay.
And
that's definitely the best reason.
Straight to the point. Okay.
Yeah, there's no time for a wolf. I was in this place, mate.
Let's have it. Yeah, 1-2, and what a track that is. By the way, Nick, you know the drums in that? It reminds me of a bit of an old-school 2000 track, Fiesta. It had, like, the drums in it.
I mean, it could be, because, I mean, this one's Calypso, so it's on the same sort of vein, I suppose.
Yeah, it sounds like they've took the drums off it, the drum sample.
Yeah. Kind of give a bit more energy into it, the kind of rolling.
Yeah. Energy. Gives it the energy.
It's got very nice bongos.
Oh, we've got some shout-outs, Shell, which is great.
Yes, we have. We've got loads of people. And unfortunately, I can't shout you all out because there's so many in there.
I mean, it's great to have Golden Days.
We've got Golden Days guys in there. We've got Rick Jones in there, which is amazing because he was a huge part of New Dawn.
And also, thanks for Dave Minstrel as well for helping out, getting this together on the monitoring and helping out on the group. It's been great, you know. So, all help get... I mean, it's so hard, isn't it, to get, you know, on social media today. There's so much about, you know, it's just saturated, isn't it, with stuff.
Yeah, it's a big platform. It's huge.
So,
But, yeah, I mean, I have got a question, another one, which I would like to ask... probably I'll ask James this one first. Oh, are you ready? Yeah.
I'm not muted again.
No, you're not muted. Yeah, my question is, like, obviously you guys were one of the earliest, shall I say, to start this sort of thing off, and you inspired so many people and so many people to become DJs. And I just want to know really individually what inspired you to become a DJ.
Ooh.
Sorry, put you on the spot a bit. Ooh,
yeah. I think this is coming to us all. Shell's got.
Yeah, get ready. It's coming
ready
to all
I'm
of you.
I couldn't say exactly, but when the electro sound started, and my mate Jeff used to walk down the street with his great big stereo, and he was blasting the wiki
one. Sounds like me.
God, yeah.
Electro one on repeat we had. And it just, I was absolutely amazed by it. You know, it's like, what is this sound? And then from that, you know, listening to the electro, the early hip hop, sold out. Stu Allen was such an influence.
Yeah.
And people like Chad Jackson as well. You know, these were people from where we were from. And this amazing new sound, and I was getting really into the, I used to listen to the hip hop and the soul, and then Stu Allen started the House Hour.
Yeah.
And, wow. And I can remember all the new music, and I actually went and bought a pair of belt drive turntables. They weren't even sound labs; they were Tandy.
Tandy. Did you have the little mixer as well? A little Tandy mix.
Yeah, and the batteries kept running out.
Fucking batteries.
Yeah, batteries. And it was a dreadful setup.
It was really a dark ages, wasn't it?
Is that the realistic range, wasn't it, Tandy?
Yeah, that's it. Mm. That's the one. Yeah.
But not very realistic.
Yeah, there was no start-stop button, so I ended up making a box.
Oh, wow.
Hey, by the way, James, was it the dials for the pitch, or was it... Because my first ones had the dial for the pitch.
Rotary.
Yeah, rotary.
No, these were proper faders, but there was no crossfader.
Oh, no, sorry, I mean for the actual turntables.
Oh, no, the... it was a little... Yeah, it was a little dial.
Strobe
on the front. And you have to bend down and look at the strobe.
Wow.
And you had to do that with your fingers, didn't you? Like, to get it, like, speed
it
up.
It was awful, yeah. Mm. Yeah. Wow. The quality was appalling. So I just got started because I was just fascinated by it. That was all. And then it sort of...
snowballed.
Just went from there. Yeah. Brilliant. Can I give that same question to you, Nick, please?
Yeah, so when we used to do, like, I was into all the breakdancing, a bit of lino and all that malarkey. Used to go up Roxy Roller Inc. Daz used to DJ there, in fact.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. And doing the pop stuff. But before that, when I was I was 12. Used to listen to Mike Allen, National Fresh.
Oh, on Radio 1?
Radio 1, which is amazing.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. Obviously, all the electros and stuff. And then after that, it was Jeff Young's Big Beat that sort of took over. And that's the first time I heard Chime on Jeff Young's Big Beat. But the DJ part, I was when we went to parties as a family and that, I was always hanging around the DJ and watching what I was doing. And I was always playing on my dad's deck, mixing Glenn Miller.
Hey, good art, good choice though.
Buddy made some money at that, didn't they?
Yeah, James last, make the party last. but yeah, so I just had a fixation with it, and it just carried on. So yeah, I just love it. I still love it now. I love the buzz of it. So,
did you have a moment when you got your turntables, Nick, and you kind of started learning how to mix? Did the pin drop? Did it take you? Did someone teach? I mean, no one taught me, and I'm sure I know. I don't know about James, but what about you, Nick? Did you teach yourself? Were you a self-taught?
Well, the first decks I had. In fact, if I missed something, aren't I? I was a roadie for a guy, for one of the DJs from the club, Alan. And when the club, which obviously became Freetown, when that closed down, they had some Technics D202s, I think they were.
Very first ones.
Yeah, so and they gave them, and they were belt drive.
Mm-hmm.
No, they were direct drive, but they were really... pants.
Directly. Did they have the rotary on as well for the pitch?
Yes, they did.
Mm-hmm.
And so I learned to mix on that. And when I eventually got Techniques, which I had from, I got them when I was at Minstrels, after Evergreens and that, mixing was fucking doddle compared to the other ones.
Yeah.
It's like, it's so easy.
can you remember the rubber mats that came with the Techniques? They're about half a centimetre thick, weren't they? The big rubber mats. They were gone straight off, weren't they? You know, but I mean, you know, having the Techniques, like, you know, the 1210s, it was like amazing, wasn't it? You know, feeling to actually, yeah, you know, get them. So yeah.
Can I ask you the same question, please, Scott?
Absolutely. I'm going to have to make this really brief because it's a long story. But I was very similar to James. I was really into hip-hop, early electro, all that kind of stuff. And getting those... Because I think some of the electro albums, they had like mixes, didn't they, on the other... There was like an extra disc with mixes on and Chad Jackson and all that was on there.
Mm-hmm.
So I had that. I was also listening to one of the best, like, the DJs that was.
That was
really
Ultimate
into.
Tracks, wasn't it?
Was it Ultimate Tracks?
Ultimate Tracks,
yeah.
Volume 1, that. DJ yeah, that was Jack the
one. Jackson. Oh, yeah, that was it. And I heard that kind of thing going on. And I was also listening to DJ Jazzy Jeff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Amazing.
DJ Jazzy Jeff, like, the most amazing. He's like my hero DJ in terms of what he did with that. And he did on one of the albums that they put out, it was live at Union Square in 1984, and DJ Jazzy Jeff does live, the first time ever, the Transformer scratch.
Yeah, make it chirp.
The way everybody kind of did DJing and scratching at that point, and that blew me away. So that was kind of some early influences. But bizarrely, full circle, with Signal Radio, a mate of mine, Jason Lee, who did a bit of DJing with me at school in the school hall one night afternoon. We did that, got our dad's speakers down to this school hall and got our decks and similar stuff. You know, one's got a pitch control, one hasn't. I mean, you know, it was terrible. You couldn't mix the toffee. But all those experiences, and then he got in touch with me. He said, "Oh, you want to listen to this DJ on Signal Radio called Lee Finan?" And he was DJing.
Lee Finan.
Yeah, he was mixing live on a high energy sort of disco, gay disco stuff. But it was brilliant, and I could hear him like really trying to mix it, and because you could hear him making mistakes, I could learn from that as well. Mm-hmm. So it's sometimes nice to hear the human touch and hear the reality of what someone's trying to mix. And that's how I learned. It was like listening to other DJs and getting that kind of... So bizarre, from Signal Radio, before I was even a proper DJ or anything like that, I ended up on Signal Radio with Meeting of the Minds 4 or 5 years later. Doing what we were doing on, you know, me and James used to pick up his Technics decks on the way down on a Sunday night, drive down the M6, then to Stoke-on-Trent to go into the
commitment. Commitment.
Huge.
10 o'clock on a Sunday night till 1 a.m. and all the way back again. But we were out on the Friday night doing an all-nighter and the Saturday night in the club.
Yeah.
The Sunday night in the show. But that's how I got to that point, was listening to other DJs, and those kind of influences inspired me. Yeah.
Wow, that's cool.
I suppose you asked me.
I am going to ask you, Daz. Yeah, you're not getting out of it.
Very similar to James Antics, and a lot of DJs back in the 80s was the hip hop. I saw Malcolm McLaren on the YouTube on Tube, and he was showing the hip hop how the DJs were getting two records and using the breakbeat and using that two of the same tracks, and they were just repeating that bit just for the breaks and doing the scratch, and I was just mesmerized because I was already doing sort of discos for the school disco that was, you know, I was still young then, so just blew me a mind. And then I got me, like you, James, had got me Tandy's decks with belt driven, you know, and it was didn't understand anything about mixing. I was going to the place and just, you know, hoping that I could play some tunes there, and I just watched and waited for a DJ not to turn up, and he didn't, and I got to play some tracks. And after then, I started wanting to learn about mixing. So I got two records that were the same and learned how to beat match through that, because I didn't understand beat match. No one taught me. So it was just a, you know, pin drop, you know, that's how I started. And it was just from there, really. But yeah, it was all the hip hop, all the scratching and all that. That's where it started for me. And, you know, it was just the rest, you know, is just like yourselves, is history, and we're here today. So yeah, hip hop for me.
So with that in mind, what's your old school track then, Daz?
Okay, yeah, so you're going to want... this is one of my old school tracks that resonates with me. It's one of my go-to tracks for everything to do with the scene for me, because it's when I was going to the Hacienda, that was a turning point for me when I went to the Hacienda and discovered, like, this warehouse-type venue. You know, it was, wow, it was just an eye-opener. Have any of you guys been to the Hacienda, by the way? Did you ever go? So yeah. you know, coming from, it was industrial, wasn't it? It was something so different. And I always remember, for some reason, they played this track, the last track of the night. I always remember I could hear the shutters coming down and the glass collectors going around. And it was just like, you know, it was a sad moment, but the track itself is such an uplifting track. So it is CC Rogers, and it is Someday, and it just resonates everything for me from where it started. So I hope you enjoy. So that's my emotional trap for the night. For everyone who's been the Hacienda, and I think just for that time frame, it screams out everything to do with that time period. It does for me anyway. So that was Someday CC Rogers, and we all know it's been sampled, hasn't it, as well, the piano.
Yeah, it has. It's very emotional, though, that original, isn't it? It's really nice.
What about you guys? Have you got any connection with that track?
Just bloody love it.
Yeah.
Just bloody love it, mate. It's a lot slower, isn't it? And it is one of those you don't really mix in, I guess. You just kind of, it just plays, and that's it.
like I say, it was the end track, and it was sad because it was the end of the Hacienda. And it's funny how they used to play it, the last... It was either that or... I can't think of the other one they used to play. Very, very similar to that. From the Angels from Above, Fall Down, that's what I mean? Joe Smooth. Yeah, thanks. That's the one, Nick. There was that or that one, and it was the end of the night, and it was... So, yeah, that's my first... choice.
Are we going to go for the new track now, Daz, and what's the connection to this one?
Well, yeah, there is a connection to this, and it's through you, Shell, actually. The track itself is it pronounced Noisy?
I think it's Noisy.
Noisy.
Noisy or Noisy.
And it's called Summer 91, which reflects on, obviously, who wrote it. They definitely wrote it, for the early 90s feel.
Yeah.
So that's what I thought with the track anyway. And I heard it from you, Shell, first. So, this is it's my new track. I hope you enjoy this.
When you don't realise you're in the moment until it's a memory. I just can't stop looking back, looking back, looking back.
Yeah, so there you go. There's my new track. And Nick, any idea what the connection was to? No, it was who played it earlier?
Well, it was Nick, wasn't it? It was a was it the Moby track?
Moby track.
I'm sure, it's got a Moby sample James. In there.
That was mine.
Sorry, James.
Yeah, did you pick up on it, James?
Sorry,
Daz, I have actually got that tune. I downloaded it last year.
Right. Okay. So
yeah, I have played it a few times.
Have you? Oh, it's just brilliant. I heard Charlie playing. It was just like so happy and uplifting. It's a great. They've captured like the old school essence, haven't they, in that track?
Yeah, they really have. It's really good. Yeah. I like that one. I like the piano melody.
By the way, I do think we should ask Shally where she started DJing and what inspired her, because she's not getting away with it. Come on, Shell.
Yeah, well, go on, Shell.
When did the penny drop with you?
Well, not that long ago, actually, to be perfectly honest. I don't know. What was it? About 3 years ago? My brother was an old school DJ. He used to play at his local working man's club, and when they had the discos on and stuff on his vinyls, and he had his Technics, his 1210s and stuff. So I had a bit of a go, and I used to, well, when they used to be too mullered to even see the crossfader, then little sister used to jump on and slam a few of his vinyls on. And they always said, oh, you've got a great ear for a great track. And I used to go vinyl shopping with him on a Saturday after listening to a bit of Stu Allen or You Guys on the New Dawn on Sunday night. And then Saturday after, we used to end up in Global Groove. And we used to be trying to sing these songs and saying, oh, it's this, you know, things like that. So it's always been around me, and I've always loved the scene. But actually picking up a set of headphones was only recently, about 3 years ago. And this was literally due to the fact that my brother had got a gig, because he's still quite an active DJ now. And the DJ that he was playing with, who was supposed to be back-to-back with, actually backed out. He was ill and he couldn't play. And he got a gig about 2 days later. And I just said, literally, in conversation, well, if I could do it, I would, mate. You know I'd help you out. And he was like, I can actually get you to play. You will be able to do it. It's dead easy on these controllers. And then we went from there. And it was literally from there. So I did a back-to-back with him. First, well, 3 days after learning how to play on a controller, 3 days later I was in a nightclub with a room full of people doing a back-to-back, which was... And then I just got the buzz. I got the complete buzz from it. You know what it's like when you've got a crowd in front of you and you're vibing off them and you just get that ultimate buzz. And that was it. I was sold. I was hooked. And then a week later, he literally said to me, right, you know, get on a download site, see if you can pick 10, 15 tracks and let's see what you come up with. And I did, and I put a brilliant set together, and they were all in key, they were all nice, and then I just learned to mix from there, really, and just listened to people and just went from there. So that was really where I started. So I suppose it was my brother, really, that inspired me, and you guys, obviously, and people like that, really.
It's funny you should mention, Shell, about it being in key, your choice of music, because, I mean, back when we started, and I'm sure about you guys, we had a crate of box of records, and you'd take one out, you put one on, does that go? No, take another one out. And by the end of the night, your records weren't in sleeves. You were just like flipping through, is that a note? No, you know. So, you know, with technology, Nick, as you know, we've got the ability to, it tells you the key now, doesn't it?
I mean, I don't miss not finding a record when I need I used to hate that. God, where is it?
Panic.
Yeah, that did you? You were like this, weren't you? 100 miles an hour flipping through them, you know. It was just something special about. And when you were in a club and it sweated, oh no, and it was like dripping from the ceiling, and your records were covered in sweat,
oh, no.
And you're wiping them in. Oh, some of the things we went through, Shell.
I was going to say, they've got it easy now, aren't they, really? They really have, you know.
There's probably an old recording of a meeting of the Minds radio show where our records are all skipping and jumping because we've been playing in the clubs all weekend, and then go straight to the studio on the Sunday night, and they're all ruined.
They've all got sweat still on them.
So, I mean, yeah, New Dawn, you know, it's it is something that we're going to do, I think, isn't it? It's, you know, this is a pilot little, like, taster. So, you know, how's everyone been in chat? Have you been enjoying it? Have you guys in chat enjoyed it? Has everything been, you know, what you expected?
Yes.
If you can let us know, you know. Any questions, please, now is the time.
I've got a question. Do people know what's coming next?
Ah, that's a good question.
That's a good question.
Do we know what's coming next?
It's not a clue.
Really, just put this together.
According to this sheet, we should have finished by now anyway.
Oh, well. You know, just like it was before, innit?
Oh, dear.
I've got a sheet.
I
had a ring. Oh, God. Yeah, whatever. Nick, you haven't got it printed out?
See, we're quite organised. Look, we've got a printed sheet and everything. We're
I thought you were a bit quiet, Nick.
I have got a message actually for you, Daz. It is from your old lighting guy. Apparently, is in the chat.
All right,
Maxime's.
Oh, Rob Thurston.
Well, he's called Chum 72 in here, so it might be him.
Oh, okay. If it is,
he says hi.
Hi, big up, Rob. If it is you, Rob Thurston, I mean, you know, he was a great guy. He started on the lighting. If it is, ask him just to make sure it is. Ask him if it is Rob.
Is it Rob?
Is it you, Rob? Is it? But I mean, yeah. Any special memories, guys, from Signal? Anything that happened on the way or in the studio that what we can remember?
we used to smoke in the studio.
Wow.
Back then. Yeah.
Yeah. It was hazy, wasn't it? There was a fog in there.
There was a fog.
Yeah, my mind was foggy after the weekend and then rocking up to sing. Yeah, it was, I mean, to think, how long did it run for? Can you remember?
No idea.
If someone can tell us in the chat. We started in
how long was I working?
We started in early 91 on the radio, I would think.
Yeah. And we would be out, we'd do an all nighter on a Friday night. Then we'd be out till 2 a.m.
That'd be Rock World, wouldn't it?
Yeah, Rock World.
Limit Saturday, was it?
No, it was Rock World. No, it was Limit Friday, Limit Saturday.
Wasn't Rock World until six in the morning, easily? Because I used to rock up there.
And then a radio on a Sunday, and how I didn't lose my job.
Yeah, because, I mean, people forget that. Full-time jobs as well, your Monday to Fridays. Yeah. I mean, God. Yeah. Wow.
We weren't paid a lot.
I don't think we were paid anything. I think we were just glad to get down there and continue the party from Friday night. It was great fun, though, wasn't it, guys? You know, we were just in the moment. I mean, you know, people forget, to us, we were just in the moment when we created what we created. And, you know, we would have thought that sort of, 30 years plus it would be us talking about, you know, sort of reviving the show.
Yes.
I hadn't realised until earlier when you said it was 30 years, that kind of... shot me a little bit.
Yeah.
Just never 30 years.
It's kind of quarter of your life, isn't it?
It's a while ago.
Yeah.
Well, the difference with the show back then and what we're doing here, obviously, the show back then, we had a Signal Radio DJ, like one of their own guys, manning the controls because we weren't seen fit to do such things on our own.
You weren't trusted. That was the thing, was it?
Well, you took one look at us and he went,
no.
It's like not letting these the controls. But it's kind of the difference now. We're doing it ourselves, aren't we? It's amazing. We've got it.
It's great.
Video and online. And someone's put a comment here about, you know, all the chat love to hear the tunes, liking the mix of tunes and stuff. And I think it is, you know, this is a bit of an intro, get to meet us again, just to tell you something about our history and where we've all come from. And it's taken other people like Rick, who's in the chat, and Nick, and loads of other DJs have been part of the New Dawn story and the Meeting of Minds show, and like everyone that was ever involved in any clubs and guests and everything. They've all, you know, influenced and been out there for people who are listening and looking at people who are in the chat and watching us now. Maybe they're wondering what's coming next.
Well, do you know what? It might be a good chance to ask, do you think we should get some of the DJs on as a bit of a guest in between doing, you know, what do you think? You know, like, if I don't know if Rick wants to come on and have a chat with us.
Rick does.
Okay, and is it a thumbs up
Oh, I think we've got a thumbs up. Yeah, we've got Rick lined up.
Nice one, Rick.
Go on, mate.
Lined up as well.
Well, brilliant. Guys.
Great.
I think you might have a show on your hands here then. I think this might be a repeat. What do you think? What do you reckon?
So do you think we should sort of do a bit of a guest DJ and then mixing, you know, have you guys on the decks with the cameras doing a mix and then a DJ to sort of interview and then have them doing a mix maybe on the next show? Just trying to mix it up a little bit for the monthly show.
Yeah, I think so. Sounds good. Yeah, sounds good. Are we get,
do people know this? We're doing a monthly show. I think
I think Daz does.
You can get it out there. That's the plan. Let's make it happen.
I think we should. Shall we? Well, if everyone has agreed, Daz, then yeah.
If you want a monthly show, just put a one in chat. If you don't, put a two.
By the hype in the group and the social media and that, I think there's definitely a call for it and stuff like that. So the ones are coming in. Look, they're on the way. So
should we go for it then, guys? Should we do it monthly?
Does that mean they're asking for one more?
One more.
What was the track that we said we would go back to?
Dusky. Dusky. Ingrid is a hybrid.
Mm. Yes, Daz is now on the search.
Robbie Williams remix of Angles, and then
What is it, Nick?
Dusky, Ingrid is a hybrid.
Okay, well, I'm just having a search for it now. Is this a particular mix of it? Is it a remix or?
It's epic. It's an absolute banger. God.
Yeah.
Well, I
said it again. Banger, sorry.
The doctor's in the house.
So definitely I think we should go forward. Let's get the original guest DJs on. If anyone knows anybody that was involved, just let us know. You know, we're open for feedback, suggestions. You know, it's your show as much as ours, isn't it? The listeners' show. You know, it's important that you know they get their feedback in as well.
Yeah, it is, and we love all the feedback. We love all the memories. We love, you know, it's been great fun reading through some of the memories and everybody chatting together and stuff like, and seeing the old flyers there, Ace. We love it.
Yeah, I mean the groups as well. Anything in the group, you know, it's good. Anything like that. But going just to mention, have you got any gigs coming up? By the way, I know you've got a big one at the end of the year, haven't you? Coming up that we. The Shelleys, obviously. Have you got anything in between?
I've got a list. I've got to go.
Come on,
I'll kick us off.
Party, maybe.
Oh, there you go, Nick. Yeah.
I'll say after you go.
I think we've got Nick's boat is going to set sail, isn't it, Nick, at some point?
Yeah, May the 18th.
Fantastic.
Tell us a bit about it, Nick. Yeah.
We do it twice a year, May and September. And it's just 100 people on the River Dee in Chester, on the Lady Diana, and it's 6 till 10, and it's just 4 hours of people, as soon as they get on there, dancing. Great bunch of people come all the time. It looks quite exclusive, I suppose, of 100 people.
VIP? So,
yeah. If you're interested, give us a shout. We put a coach on as well, so comes from Leek and goes through MFI roundabout. You have to be old enough to know what the MFI roundabout is.
Can you get
I think.
Yeah, there isn't. There is a gym. And can you get all of you through your socials, Nick? Is there any YouTube footage or anything you can have a look at, or is it on Facebook?
Yeah, or if you go on to Anthemia, I'll put it in the chat, actually.
Put your links in. Come on, guys, get your links in so they can have a look. Which I know that's been going for a few years now, hasn't it, Nick? It's been doing really well.
We have been doing it for quite a few years, actually. I mean, the first one we ever did was 1990. That was on the Thames.
That isn't the one that got shut down and the helicopters came it nearly sunk. So good, good, yeah. So that's anything else, Nick, in the pipeline? Have you got you've got other things?
There'll be something I can't say yet, but I'll probably the end of next week.
Yep. And also you've got Dave Pierce as well. Working alongside myself, Dave Pierce and Shelley.
Yeah, Tia Cheadle. Cheadle. Big rave.
With the family. That's going to be interesting, family isn't rave. It? Family rave.
In a field.
In a field.
I wonder if Dave is coming on his helicopter in the field. What about you, James? Antics? Anything?
The Shelley's reunion.
Yes.
In November. That's all I have got booked in at the moment, and the radio. But I am available for bookings. I've finished the bathroom, so I'm ready to go.
Yeah, that's why we've been working on it for so long. We've been waiting for the bathroom to be finished, haven't we?
Waiting for the bathroom.
you're back on the scene a bit now. Everyone seems to take a break. You need to, don't you? Mm-hmm. You know, you've got family life, and, you know, it comes kind of secondary, doesn't it? And then all of a sudden, you've got it in your blood again. It's like, I can't stop doing this. You get pulled back in. Yeah.
But not every week. I couldn't handle it every week. No.
I didn't think my body or brain could. But what about you, Cherokee?
Cherokee or Scott? Which is it? Scott Cherokee? I've been really lucky.
Scott Cherokee.
A big shout out to the Golden Days crew and to Selena as well, who's been helping on the group chat as a moderator and banging some brilliant tunes on there as well.
Good, good.
And everyone that's kind of come out of the... Well, I shouldn't say come out of the woodwork, but for me, it's been amazing. I've been invited to play quite a few things. So obviously, James and I did Golden Days recently. Had a really good back-to-back there. Really enjoyed that. I've done a few for them. We've got another one, Golden Days at Mint Lounge in Manchester on April the 13th. There's tickets still left for the day. That's 3 till 10 p.m. And that's a brilliant crowd, brilliant crew. And I'll be doing vinyl there. I know it doesn't really matter on the floor what's going on, but I'll be doing the vinyl thing because I enjoy it. That's the reason I do it. Like I say, it doesn't matter how you're doing it. It's what you're
personal
playing.
Choice, isn't it?
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And then so got another one. Oh, go on. Sorry.
No, carry on. I was just thinking about the Golden Days. What a great, you know, promoters they are. Really genuine. Spoke to me in the week. Thanks for that connection. They just, you know, you can tell they're old school, you know, definitely. So they've got some good things. They've done some good things and got some good things in the pipeline.
The thing about them is they really care about the people. They've got a really great support group for everyone as well, because we've all been through things in our lives, and everyone knows that. And everyone is about talking, not about that when you're out having a good time, but there's a support network there for everybody who's part of that family. And I think that's the really special thing.
Yeah, it is.
The thing that really, you know, has helped me as well.
I know time's running off with it, I'll be quick, but there is a massive change with the club scene. And back then, there was no phones. You went out there, you didn't have any social media, you didn't talk about anything beyond the club. You were just in the club, you were hugging and, you know, feeling the moment, and the tunes are dropping, the hands in the air, the whistles, the horns. And now it's kind of different. It has changed. Without a doubt, whether it's for the better or for the worse, that's personal opinion, you know. So,
it's good. It's good when you're in the moment, isn't it? And lost in that moment together, in that moment of euphoria, having a good time.
Yeah,
the troubles have gone away.
Yeah,
having a good time together. But so I'm really pleased. I'm playing with them again, and then I've got a night for Energy 91, who I played for just before Christmas. They've got a new venue, the Zombie Shack in Manchester. That's on the 11th of May. There's tickets available for that. I'll post a link in a bit.
Cool.
DJ Cherokee on Facebook. And then, really looking forward to that massive one at Shelley's at the end of the year, 9th of November, isn't it?
Yeah, and
Antics back to back again.
Shelley Tracks Radio. I mean,
I've got a
big shout out to Tracks.
Massive big shout out to Tracks Radio.
I mean,
for providing this platform, this amazing platform.
Well, it's you and Simon.
Well, I met you.
Yeah, you are Tracks, yeah, along with Simon, you know, and he came up with the idea, and we approached, you know, way before Christmas about the idea, and yeah, we were just talking about it, and, you know, I'm so grateful that we've got a platform to stream, and it's in Stoke as well.
Yeah.
So it's, so, you know, thanks for that, guys, Tracks. Yeah. So shall...
Your bit's in Stoke. Your bit's in Stoke.
Yeah, yeah. I suppose it's been like streamed from Stoke, so it's kind of still got its heritage a little bit. The New Dawn. It's everywhere, worldwide now, isn't it?
Yeah, well, that's
And, do you want to say as well, Shelley, that you've put a great amount of work into getting this off the ground, and you, Daz, and
you,
Simon, as well, who's hiding in the background somewhere.
He's our ears on the ground.
He's the moderator. He's been phoning us and telling us off, aren't he?
Yeah.
I'm only joking. He's lovely, a sign.
I think singularly, none of us would have had the energy to get all this off the ground, but together,
It's been a team effort, hasn't it?
And it's been great bringing it back. Do you know, it feels right. It feels about the right time and things like that. So it's just, like I said from the start, it's just really nice to get you guys together. And
do you want to mention the next show? We have got a date, haven't we?
Got a date for the next New Dawn online event and show, which is the 7th of April, which will all go online and all go live pretty soon. We'll be back. It'll be probably a bit different than this, and we'll probably work out a bit of a different show for you, maybe have a bit of mixing and things like that.
Yeah, mixing, definitely.
Yeah.
I think that'd be a good way to the mixing side of it. So,
we'll definitely be back. There's definitely a call out there for it, and yeah.
So is that the 7th
of April.
7th of April. Mm-hmm. It's not too far away.
No, not really.
That'll soon come round. Anyway, guys, anything you want to... Last words before we end with the last track of the night?
Well, I really enjoyed it. I know you can't see me, but...
Nick? Hello?
Where are you?
We've lost Nick.
Where are you? I'm back in a minute.
The only thing I want to say towards the end now is just a thank you to everybody who's taken the time to actually come online and listen to our random ramblings.
Yeah. Big love there, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. It's been great. Thank you.
No, it has, and it's been really, and we didn't know if it was going to work, if it wasn't, you know, and it's just a bit of a suck it and see sort of show, but it's really nice that people have joined in and jumped on board with it, and some lovely comments and a lot of love out there, so yeah, it's all good.
I mean, it's just great to talk about memories, isn't it, really, as well, and you know, we could just fill a show with memories and you know, just but you know, we'll do more of these cast podcasts, but next time it's going to be more mixing, I think, and we'll get the guest DJ and that James has managed to hook up with Scott, Rick Jones.
Yeah, it'd be good to get some of the live mixing on there, wouldn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Definitely next time. Is it going to be a 2-hour show?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I think we'll go for 2 hours. Well, we've gone nearly 2 hours now, so...
Okay, well, 2 hours then.
Yeah, 2 hours, I think. I think we'll try and allocate 2 hours.
Happy days.
It doesn't seem like 2 hours, does it?
It flies, doesn't it? It goes really fast.
Right, so, yeah, I think we'll go over to the last track. So just tell us again about this track, please.
It's the Dusky.
The Dusky.
Played it at a festival... and it's just massive. It's really good. It's I followed it in fact with Space Shanty, Left Field. I don't know if you know that one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But yeah, so it was that kind of, come on, you're having it.
Oh, it's sounding a bit Prodigy. Anyway, good night. God bless everybody. And thanks for tuning in so much. And give us some feedback and let us know what you think about the show, please.
Yeah, we will stay on Mixcloud for a little bit longer so we can all jump in the chat and So if you got any more questions, ask away.
So see you later, guys. God bless.
Cheers, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.